This video is brought to you by AKSIAS.
Welcome to AKS Daily News Analysis of the Hindu Newspaper, dated 20th March 2020 of Hyderabad edition. The first article taken up for discussion is from page number 10. The article here is talking about the central government, which is rethinking of giving a new definition to the MSMEs, popularly called as micro, small and medium enterprises. These MSMEs have come into foray with the act called as Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Development Act of 2006. Basically, this act divides these MSMEs into two types, namely manufacturing and the services. Earlier, their classification was based on the investments in the plant and machinery. If you can see, earlier within the manufacturing sector, the micro industries were those where there was an investment up to 25 lakhs, and they'll be classified as small if the investments are from like something between 25 lakhs to 5 crore, and medium for 5 crore to 10 crore. Whereas within the services, they were classified as micro if they're investing around 10 lakhs, and for small from 10 lakhs to 2 crore, medium from 2 to 5 crores. Now they want to revise it. The main reason why they want to revise this classification is because earlier they had to incur the expenses in order to physically verify the actual assets as well as to chart up the actual investment mode, right? Because they're considering here the management in plant and machinery, maybe any officer who has to calculate about the classification of this MSMEs have to go physically and then see what are the investments they have done in the plant and machinery. So now the RBI has established a new committee in the name of UK Sinha. This UK Sinha has given 39 suggestions. The center has now accepted all these 39 suggestions, including the fund of the funds, and they have trying to give a new definition by just talking about the turnover. It seems like for micro industries, the turnover should be for around 5 crores. For small, it should be between 5 to 75 crores. And for medium, it may be between 75 to 250 crores, right? These MSMEs are again very important part of our economy, as they contribute around 24% to our GDP and 48% to the exports. But yet, this sector seems to be like having so many of hurdles it has been facing before. The mainly because this sector did not get the pending payments by the governments as well as the public sector undertakings. So now they are considering of taking or owning this UK Sinha's committee's recommendations in order to help the sector of the ongoing corona pandemic, because we see that exports have drastically reduced. So in turn it will also impact these industries, right? So they may be taking few other measures in order to equip this MSMEs with a robust kind of mechanism. Next, the article here is talking about the message which was given by our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, a very strong and effective message, right? So here he called upon the India to fight the coronavirus with collective determination as well as patience, so that humanity as well as the India will prevail in this world, right? Here he called upon the 9 action task force to be done by the citizens of India so as to beat this coronavirus. In this context, he has called for the first thing called as Janata curfew, right? He asked the people in order to follow a curfew on Sunday, that is March 22nd, from 7 a.m. to 9 p.m. That means that no people should go out or gather in their societies, but yet just stay at home. The second call he has called upon is about the panic buying, as we are seeing that many of the people are trying to stock their homes, especially of the food items, right, including the medicines. He says that such type of hoarding should be restrained by the people, because India does not fall short of any kind of essential requirements. So people should not involve this in the panic buying. Third one he called upon is about the senior citizens. asking that people who are like above 60 years, they should avoid going out in the next couple of weeks, because as we see that coronavirus is mostly affecting the people above the 60 years of age. The fourth mantra he talked about is about the social distancing. That means people should keep at least 1 to 3 meters away from when they are trying to interact with others, and they should also give away the attitude that they can escape this disease, right? The fifth call that he has called upon is about the health services, asking people not to go if at all they have some kind of surgeries and all, if at all they are not very compulsive, and as well as he asked the people to avoid the health services. Now talking about the employers, he asked that trade as well as the affluence should look upon the interest of the staff, and they should not penalize the staff for not being able to attend the work because of the travel and other restrictions. And he asked another novel thing, like what has just been done in the Italy. On Sunday, exactly at 5 p.m., people should step out of their balconies, and they should beat the thalis or the metal plates in order to express the appreciation for the work of the workers at the hospitals, airports, railways, and other essential services. He took a jibe on the economic impact of this pandemic, and he says that they are going to form a COVID-19 task force, which will be headed by the finance minister, that is Nirmala Sitaram, and here she will consult with the stakeholders, and she will come up with the measures to add to the crisis so that people are out of this economic hardship. It seems like this pandemic is going to majorly affect the middle as well as the lower middle classes and our poor economically. So he has asked all these industrialists and the institutions to equip with giving an amount of salary to these workers. Next, the article here is talking about giving Human Rights Commission more powers, right? So we all have been listening about the National Human Rights Commission as well as the State Human Rights Commission from our polity books, right? So these commissions have come into foray with the act called as Protection of Human Rights Act of 1993. The main purpose of this act was to establish an institutional framework so that these institutions can effectively protect, promote, as well as fulfill the fundamental rights which were guaranteed in our Indian Constitution. For this purpose, under this Act, they have established both NHRC and HSRCs at various levels. But yet, the article here beautifully tries to talk about the word called as fourth branch institutions, right? But yet, if we kind of see our classical definition in the polity, we see that our democracy is sustained through the distribution of powers between three organs, what we popularly call them as legislature, executive, and the judiciary, right? With each of this branch will act as a check and balances between them. But yet, the necessity has shown that we also need an extra branch so that we can overcome the complexity of governance as well as administration in this modern world, right? So because of this complexity, it has necessitated for the existence of set of independent bodies. We usually see independent bodies in the name of constitutional bodies or the non-constitutional bodies, right? We are also familiar with the constitutional bodies like CAG and the Chief Election Commissioners, and non-constitutional bodies here include bodies such as NHRC and HSRC. These bodies have been given a different kind of charge so that they'll perform a vital functions called as oversight, right? These bodies have been established by the law, so we do not see their mention in our constitution at all. But now the scrutiny has again come into the foray. The reason why today we are talking about this NHRC is that recently a Madras High Court has got a petition from a person asking it to decide on whether the recommendations which are made by such panels are binding on the state or not, right? Because in this 25 years of its existence of the Human Rights Commission, we get to see a lot of criticism about these institutions, right? because some institutions say that these autonomous bodies are laying towards the politicization, but yet some more people say that they have become toothless. That means that if you see, basically the recommendations which are given by the NHRC are advisory in nature. So the basically government is left free in order to disobey or even disregard these findings what are being done by these advisory bodies. So now a full bench of the High Court of the Madras will be deciding upon whether the recommendations, the word here has become a very, very controversy, because they are saying that the recommendations which were given by the NHRC or HSRC are basically recommendatory in nature, right? So here the word comes kind of two deflating kind of concepts it is trying to give. One, it will have a straight meaning. Recommend meaning is nothing but to suggest or put forward, right? In the same way, it also has another meaning called as obligation on the government. So now the Madras court will decide upon this obligation to see whether the recommendations given by this NHRC is binding upon the respective state, or whether the government is entitled to reject or take no action upon them. Right, before we talk about what the article wants to say, or later when the High Court comes up with the suggestions, first let us see what are the powers this NHRC or the HSRC has got. So basically the NHRC or the HSRC are being empowered in order to inquire into the violations of human rights which are basically committed by the state authorities. Like, either they can go forward with the petitions if they are getting any kind of petitions, or sometimes these bodies can also initiate their own initiatives, right? And in this context, these bodies have a power of a civil courts. That means that while conducting the inquiries, these commissions are given the same identical power to that of the civil courts. So they can examine the witness, order for documents, they can even receive the evidence, right? So these proceedings that this particular bodies do are deemed to be kind of judicial proceedings. That means that they can ask any person who may be judicially affected by their outcome has a right to be heard, right? So the word here, recommend, what we are talking about, comes into the limelight asking what it is to be done after this NHRC or the Human Rights Commission completes its inquiry as a civil court, right? After that, if at all this commission reaches a conclusion that the human rights have been violated, then what do we mean by the word recommend? According to one section in the Protection of Human Rights Act, it says that Human Rights Commission can recommend to the concerned government to grant compensation, right, to the victim in order to initiate the proceedings against the state authorities, or it can also grant interim relief, and it also can take various steps. So the key question revolves around the meaning of this word called as recommend, but yet there are also opposite conclusion by the different benches of the Madras High Court. Here they say that this word needs to be taken in the ordinary sense. That means that recommend means to just suggest or put forward, right? Whereas ordinarily suggestion being the binding also in nature, including the action or the proposed to be taken there by the commission within a period of 1 month, right? So the argument therefore is that this is not only obligation upon the government. If indeed this act, so it would not simply would have just said government to communicate what action it intended to take to the commission, right? So this is the where this whole article is trying to move towards. What do they mean by the word recommend? So the question arises about the ordinary meaning for the word recommend and the meaning within the legal framework, right? So legal meaning here, it means that the purpose of the statute within which a word occurs should have a strong influence, right? Otherwise, there is no way that why they have to create such type of bodies. Otherwise, we do not even need such type of acts, and we do not even need an institutional infrastructure via the Human Rights Commission. So at last, we can conclude by saying that this Human Rights Commission basically plays a very crucial role, and so it may require, we may require the state to show more accountability, especially in a democratic country like us, so that we can bring about a culture of justification, which strongly indicates that this commission's recommendation should be binding upon the state, so that this fourth branch institutions will not only aid the three organs of our democracy, but also it will strengthen the sentiments among the people. Next, the article here is talking about the drastic but necessary. This is in context to the speakers who must realize that their action of deliberate inaction on defection matters is no more an option. They are talking here about the recent judgment given by the Supreme Court asking the Manipur minister, that is speaker, in order to take an action against the differing person. This case is basically reminding us of a person who has won the seat on the Congress ticket, but yet he has defected to the BJP. In that case, basically it refers to the anti-defection law, right? Because he is the only person who has defected to the other party, although he has won the ticket on the other party, right? So this anti-defection law, basically it is decided by the presiding officer, that is the speaker. He should decide upon this anti-defection law. And in the case of Manipur, we see that this presiding officer has delayed taking any action against a particular person for around 3 years. That is, that this thing happened in 2017, right? So here the article is saying it is a deliberate inaction of the presiding officer. So now the Supreme Court has evoked the article called as 142, saying that enforcement of decrees or orders of the Supreme Court orders so as to discover. So here it has given a time limit for the presiding officer to decide the case of anti-defection law within 4 weeks, right? So, and it also lays emphasis by saying that the courts have a power to fix the time frame. Otherwise, what happens is that this particular person, although he has defected from one party to the another, he may go unpunished, or he may be continuing in the other party until the next election comes, right? So basically it shows the how the presiding officer is kind of biased, because he also belongs to that ruling party, right? Not only that, we have also seen such case in the Panneerselvam group in the Tamil Nadu, but yet because certain group members have actually moved away from a particular group, that may not lead to the anti-defection law. But time and again, our different cases are showing us that these presiding officers are reluctant their office or not taking their particular action. So it necessitates us to rethink whether this position should be outsourced, because the speaker somehow belongs to a particular party, although constitution says that he should not, once he takes the office of the speaker, he should not owe his allegiance to any party. But seldom that those things are happening in the Indian government. So probably this presiding officer should think, or the government or the court should think about outsourcing it to some other person to decide upon this anti-defection laws. So the next article here is important, although may not be important for the prelims perspective, but for mains it is again important, because this article is directly written by our president of India. So the words basically that they use can be readily made available for our mains questions, right? So when we are writing mains answers, we can try to remember a few of the words that are being used by these dignitaries, and that will help us a lot, especially when we are talking about the keywords, right? So here our president of India is talking about the COVID-19 and how it is related to the nature, what it wants to teach us, right? He says that the nature is reminding us that we need to acknowledge with humility about the concept called as equality and the interdependence, right? So now the world is in the unprecedented situation, right? Because we have seen more than 10,000 deaths in and around the world, people talking about the coronavirus. right? So here it says that the outbreak has now forced the humans in order to keep a respectful distance from each other, called as isolation, as well as the self-imposed or the medically mandated procedure, right? So we are saying that not only because people who are coming from foreign should follow the concept of quarantine, but here also, if at all some person is showing any kind of symptoms of the coronavirus, he should maintain distance. Although such type of epidemic is not the first viral outbreak, right? We have seen so many epidemics like the cholera during 1970s. But yet, this is considered to be first epidemic given the nature, right? It is very, very contagious, and the scale, because it has affected almost every country in this world. In this way, he tries to tell few concepts which are important for us in order to fight the coronavirus, as well as trying to remind us about the basics that the India has always stood for. So here he tells the first mantra in order to beat the coronavirus is the hygiene. And in order to maintain the hygiene, first of all, this reminds us about hygiene is nothing but today, it's just a precaution, and which is considered to be the own new cure for this new strain of coronavirus, right? So now their doctors or everyone in the ads, we can talk about people talking about the sanitation as well as cleanliness, and this both are considered to be the most humblest of the civic virtues, right? So this is not something that the India has seen for the first time, because Gandhiji has always talked about such type of sanitation and cleanliness. If we have to remember here, we have to remember an incident in 1896 when Gandhiji visited India. That time basically there was a plague broke out in Bombay, right? At that time Gandhiji directly went and he offered a voluntary service to the state. Here when he was doing this voluntary service, the first thing he did was that he inspected latrines and the exhausted people to pay utmost importance to the cleanliness. So now we are celebrating his 151 birth anniversary, right? So here also during the coronavirus, people are rededicating themselves in order to maintain the personal as well as social hygiene. And we can talk about India's already initiated mission talking about the hygiene, that is called as Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, which has brought about the social awakening in the India. The second important thing that this coronavirus reminds us of is the respect for nature, right? Today we are seeing our human beings have achieved a lot of great things. They are setting a foot on other planets. They are even going and introspecting the sun. But yet today they are beaten by a small microorganism, right, which is not even seen by our eyes. So now it stands humbled by this microorganism, right? So it shows us that no small is really small and no big is really big, right? So it just depends on the organisms for survival. That shows that our people are interdependent. And as we know from the past, India has always revered the environment or the mother goddess, mother nature as a goddesses, right? So when such type of pandemics and the weather phenomena are becoming a norm, so now it is time for the people in order to pause and think where we lost and how we can still come back and pay equal respect to the nature. The third important thing that this coronavirus reminds us is about the equality, right? Now if we can see, mostly in the world they are drawing a distinction and they are wearing watch over us and them, right? But now we suddenly see how this virus had not respected any kind of borders, and it has equally affected each and every person in the world. This fourth thing that this coronavirus teaches us is about the interdependence, right? Because India has always stood forth for the interdependence value, what we call it as Vasudhaiva Kutumbam, that means whole world is a single family, right? So this is the word that India has always relied on, and its relevance today grows much more, right? So it is this extraordinary crisis is also teaching people not to be selfish, but it also thinking us to think equally of others. The fifth aspect that this virus teaches us is about the voluntary services, right? So usually voluntary services, like whenever there are floods or any kind of disaster management that comes, people have to submit or should come forward for the voluntary services. But now people are actually running away from each other. We do not see voluntary services can affect anyway. Only the doctors can do this voluntary service. But yet at this hour, the voluntary service that we can do is to try to raise the awareness, as well as equally we should refrain ourselves from spreading any kind of panic, right? And also we should think about sharing the resources, especially with the less resource people or the poor people now, who will be in great engravement given the economic slowdown, right? So here he concludes by saying that nature is reminding us in order to acknowledge with humility and equality and the interdependence. It is a lesson which is imparted to the humankind with a great kind of message it is trying to give, and we all should reaffirm ourselves in order to fight against this coronavirus. Next, the article here is talking about a need for reorientation. They basically mean by need for reorientation towards the state universities, because if we see, they are trying to draw a configuration between the central universities and the state universities, and we see that out of the 1,000 students who get award each year, 400 of them comes out from the state universities, and these state universities are the ones who produce 90% of our graduates, including their affiliated colleges, and they also contribute to the 1/3 of the research publications. But yet, although this is all in the numbers that we are talking about, talking the 490 or 1/3, but when it comes to the quality and performance, these states are really lagging behind. There is a proof for it to say that these states are lagging behind, given their institutional rankings, or talk about the employment status, quality of the publications that they are producing of the within this 1/3, negligible presence in national policy or the decision-making bodies, as well as we also get to see poor track record in receiving the national awards and recognition, as well as poor share in the research funding and so on. So these are the basic flaws that we can see in the state universities. Now let's ask a question, why are the state universities performing so badly, right? But if we go thoroughly and look at the issues about the state universities, we can find that actually there is a lack of proper diagnosis of the problem. There are mostly whatever the problems they are trying to diagnose is either fragmented or ineffective approaches they are following. True that this universities has all these flaws, but yet where exactly there is a mistake or where exactly is a flaw that this state higher education institutions are performing so badly, right? So the first thing is discarded. If we talk about, basically people hold this myth saying that most of the government universities do not perform well, right? But given the example of the IITs, we can talk, right? These IITs are also state-sponsored universities, and they are basically doing better than the other institutions, right? Even though they are also funded by the governments. So here says that, so it's not the problem about the government. Now let's talk about the central universities, right? In the central universities, if we see, most of the central universities do not face any kind of funding problem. In contrast, if we talk about the state universities, here we see the major problems behind them is that there is a lot of government as well as political interference. These universities do not even have the necessitated autonomy, poor governance, corruption, poor quality outdated circula, as well as there are concepts of plagiarism, infrastructure, facilities, overcrowding, as well as the affiliation system and the poor linkages with alumni and industries. So these are the main reasons why we are unable to achieve a greater standards among the state universities. Now if we try to compare it with the other central universities, these central universities, not only that, they have an edge over them in the funding issues, right? But yet they are also backed by the national level parties, industries, businesses, and as well as the national elite and the intelligentsia. So it is the existence of such an unwritten contract that we are seeing in the central universities is the key factor for the performance of the central universities, which are doing far better than the state universities. Otherwise, when we try to compare it with the state universities, we do not get to see any kind of consensus between the parties, neither the industries or the business, national elite or the intelligentsia, that they are giving to the state universities. That means that these state level players do not have much stake in the stability as well as performance of the state university system, right? So why? First of all, let us ask a question. Why aren't such type of provisions given to the state universities? The basic reason is that these state level players do not feel compelled in order to back the state university system more strongly, because anything that may be of particular interest and value to the state where the university is located, right? So first thing is that these do not have any kind of allegiance. What we see in the central universities, given like aims, goals, methods, whatever you talk about the institutions, this institution have something in similar to the central institutions, right? So but yet this state universities, what they do is they are only doing some people to get the graduation. They do not feel like somebody who gets graduated from these state universities will be of any help to the politicians or to the business or the industries in near future. So answer lies is that in order to receive more funding and the support, these state governments should come up with a new vision and the specific programs so that they'll address the needs of the state, industry, economy and the society. On the basis of it, make the state levels players committed to proving full ownership and support. Example, if you see, basically people, most of the industrialists support the IITians, thinking that once they get graduated, they will come and join their industry. That is how they'll make the industries go. In the same way, in the socio-economic background, if you see, these parties hope that the people who are graduating from these universities will come and join the parties, right? So in this way, these state universities also show some kind of empowerment so that this national level or the state level parties and the industries try to recruit them. So finally, the initiative here should start with a larger dialogue on the future of the state universities, so that these people will come up with a beautiful academic communities in these institutions. Next, the article here is talking about the bill which was recently passed in the Lok Sabha, and they are thinking of according a status of institution of national importance to the club of Ayurvedic institutes which are located in Gujarat Ayurvedic University campus in Jamnagar, right? So because they're giving the importance that the Ayurveda is gaining in the global world, and a lot more people are showing a lot of interest in this Ayurveda, they want to give this national status award to the Ayurvedic institutions located in the Jamnagar.